really important that we begin to change the mindset of young people to know that your vote counts.
They don't understand that the legislative arm of government is actually a co-equal arm of government.
We have an incredible amount of potential.
Whatever it is I was doing, because of my personal DNA, it had to be of an international standard,
which is what, seriously speaking, is all about.
Hello there. This is my corner. This is the table at which I'll be engaging three interesting personalities. And guess what we'll be talking about? Reading. It sounds very mundane, but it is very vital and crucial for our development as a people, and then, of course, as a nation. How many of you buy books for your kids for birthdays instead of maybe a phone or a computer? Those things are good, but how much reading can they get done with those gadgets around them? How many of you, when was the last time you read a book? Well, I ain't telling when the last time I read mine was, but on the show today, by the time I've engaged my three guests right here, you will see that reading is a serious issue. That's why that's what we're discussing today on Seriously Speaking. My name is Adesuwa Onyenukwe. You're welcome. Yes, welcome back. I have my reading glasses on because I need to read one short story to you. And it's come out of this book which says, How to Read More. It's the author of the book that I have with me in the studio. But listen to this. It's about Nkechi and the parrot. A lady called Nkechi was having a running spat with a parrot on her street, who delights in always embarrassing her every morning as she walks past to go to work. The parrot would always say, Nkechi, you too wo-wo. Translated to mean, that's pidgin English for Nkechi, you are too ugly. Finally, Nkechi goes to the owner of the parrot to please warn the parrot to desist from telling her she's too wo-wo. Of course, the owner is sympathetic and tells the parrot to lay off Nkechi and stop calling her you too wo-wo. The following morning, Nkechi is passing by to go to work as usual. The parrot sights her and the following dialogue ensues. Parrot says, Nkechi, 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 waiting, which means, what is it? Then the parrot says, but you know now, which means, but even you yourself know, I don't even need to put it in words. Nkechi, but you know now. Martin, what does it feel like hearing your book being read live in the studio? An excerpt from the book.
Yes, I mean, as I say in the book, I've read quite a number of books, okay, and I've always looked forward, I've always imagined what it would be like to have a book with my name on it, and yes,
now you have one.
Exactly.
Martin Udogie.
Exactly. So it's something that I feel very proud about. And to have somebody of the status of Adesuwa Onyenukwe reading the book, I mean, that's probably the icing on the cake.
I'll send you my bill. But I wonder, you see, the thing about this book is that it has little anecdotes like that, and it has little stories and all kinds of things that makes it seem like, is this book really about teaching you how to read? You know, by the time you finished it, you realize that I've actually finished the book. Was that a style you deliberately chose to use?
Absolutely, yes. Reading for many people is like, you know, like a chore. People see it as work. Okay, so, and I think that's why many people struggle with reading. And so what I sought to do, you know, in this book was to make reading as fun as possible. So you read the first chapter, you follow a storyline, and there's a break. So the Nkechi and the parrot story you just read is supposed to be like, you know, a funny story. So you laugh over it, you know, and then you go on to the second chapter. After the second chapter, there's another story, you know.
That helps to set the, you know, the theme.
Yeah, it helps to break the monotony. And I think that is what many people struggle with when they read, you know.
What's happening in this photo?
Well, since the book came out, actually, many organizations have been calling me to come. And because people are concerned. They want professionals. Because reading is a habit that any professional should cultivate. Because
it's not just for children.
As probably you know, reading builds vocabulary. People who read very well communicate very well, both orally and, you know, through writing, mm-hmm. okay? And so, you know, if you are running a company, you want all your, and then reading also gives you self-confidence. Mm-hmm. So if you are running an organization, you want all your staff to be very confident people, very knowledgeable people, highly informed, because these are people that can basically articulate, you know, things. They can define issues. If you are talking about competition, they can analyze, you know.
And they can contribute to any discussion.
You know, they can. If you look at also countries as well, you know, Singapore is a very good example. Lee Kuan Yew recognized from day one that he needed to have people who were extremely, extremely talented and well-educated. So many organizations have been calling me to say, please come and share this book with them.
So that was what was happening then. Well, tell me about your journey to this book. There you are, a first-class graduate from the university. In fact, you graduated best in your class when you graduated. And so you didn't have to look for a job, right? And
yes.
You ended up in the bank.
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Okay, that's interesting because it's a journey that's actually relevant to what we're discussing today. The mistake most people make, which I also made, was to associate reading with schooling.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so when I was in school, in the university, I was more like a bookworm. So I would read.
Still look
and
like
read.
One, by the way.
So, but when I started working, I just thought, okay, you only read if you have an exam to write, or, you know, when I was studying for ICANN, so I would only read then. But I remember I never read a book from cover to cover while I was in banking, okay? And I didn't think I was missing anything. If anything, anytime I saw a book, I just felt, oh, this is a snake. I never liked the look of a book until I joined a company called Accenture, and as a consultant then. And the first thing I was given, you know, the first assignment that was given to me by the managing partner then, Dotun Sulaima, was a book to read and summarize. And that book was Seven Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. And that was the first time I'll be reading a book without an exam, you know, without the mindset of, okay, I'm going to have to write an exam. And I was thoroughly, thoroughly educated by that book. And after that, I just started looking for more books to read, more books to read. And,
no, but does it mean that as a child you didn't read? Your father was a headmaster. You lost him recently.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, again, you know, then the way they used to teach us to read then was like, go read your book, you know, and then there's a cane, you know, beside him. So, and that's a mistake most parents make. Mm-hmm. What we should do is make reading fun. Let people just love reading naturally. You know, there's a story, I don't know if you're familiar with the Ben Carson story, the neurosurgeon.
You give that as an example in
exactly,
your book.
Exactly. He's one of the most renowned black, you know, neurosurgeons, he's a black American.
Yes.
But Adesua, do you know that his mother was illiterate? But he says that, you know, the mom, even though she was illiterate, she used to go clean a house of one of those big people in Atlanta and always used to, see books around. And so she recognized then that these people are successful because of books. And so she'll come home and tell Ben Carson that, look, read your book, read two books a week, and then give me a summary. So they will summarize for her. She couldn't read the summary, but she'll make some funny marks, but the children didn't know that she couldn't read, and she was illiterate. And then he said that from that habit, he just, you know, he was the dullest in his class, and then one day the science teacher shows up and says, who can identify this rock? And he was the only one. And he had read a lot about that rock. And he said, as soon as he started speaking, even the bright ones in class didn't know the rock. He mentioned the name, the history, everything. And he had the attention of the whole class. And he said, from that day, he realized that, you know, reading actually empowers you, gives you self-confidence. Mm-hmm. And he kept reading and reading. And that's what reading does, you know. People who read very well, you know, have self-confidence, you know, they speak very well, they are very articulate, and I think it's something we need to cultivate and encourage our children and every adult, you know, to do.
Did you set out to say, okay, I want to write a book, what's the first one I should write? It should be how to read a book. Or what was it about coming out with this book?
I've always wanted to write a book because I just felt having read so many, I have to also...
You became a voracious reader.
I have to also contribute.
No, what are you reading right now?
I'm reading Lee Kuan Yew. You know, he just passed...
But don't tell me you have not read that before. Is it second time reading or third time reading?
Third World to First.
Oh, okay, that's the more popular one, yeah.
That's his Bible for, you know, how to build a country. It's a phenomenal book. Mm-hmm. I've read that twice. Mm-hmm. But since his passing, I didn't want to read it third time because I virtually know what is there. And I came across this, some of the interviews he's giving and all. And then there was something he said.
Have you finished this?
I'm still reading it. Mm-hmm. You know, Lee Kuan Yew said that his definition of an educated person is somebody who never stops learning. Who never stops learning. And when I came across that quote recently, I remember something I also read about. There was a quote recently that said that we go to school to learn. Yeah? We learn how to read when we go to school, right? But when we leave school, we begin to read to learn. So when you leave school, you have to keep reading
to learn,
to keep learning, to learn more. Mm-hmm.
So is that the gap that you saw? I mean, this Lee Kuan Yew died only a few short weeks ago.
Yeah.
This book came out last year.
Yes.
You know, your book.
Yes.
And how long did it take you to write it? And why did you write it?
Okay. I think part of the reason why I wrote this book was that if you've been following me on social media, I don't know if you follow me, anytime I read a book, I always, every book has a fundamental message.
There's no question of you follow me. You send it to me anyway.
Okay, so
There's always some tape or some knowledge.
Absolutely.
I say, go try this book. Go do.
Yes.
So doesn't this guy do anything else?
So, people always used to ask me, how do you find time to read? How do you read this book?
Busy executive.
Some people will say, yeah, because I have other things I'm doing, you know.
You have a radio show.
Yes.
You have your bottom line business.
Exactly. Yeah. I do training. I do consulting. And so people keep asking me, how do you find time? How come you read so many books? You know, I have friends who will say, oh, I bought this book, but I can't read a book from the first page to the last page, you know. So I was on vacation and I had gone to this bookstore, bought so many books. You know, normally when you're on vacation, you want to do a lot of shopping. And here was I, you know, sometime finding time to read. And it just occurred to me that, okay, maybe I need to write a book on how to read books. Because, you know, reading, there's a technique to it.
Did you find that out?
Yes. And here is the distinction. When you are in school, for many of us, okay, what we do is study. I know. So what you do when you're in school, you have an exam, you have tasks. So you can read for 3, 4, 5, 6 hours because you have a deliverable, you have an exam. So that study is intense. It's not fun. So, but if you take that mindset after school and you want to start doing that while you're working, you're not going to find the time. You have other things, you know, bothering you. So when you leave school, what you should be doing is no longer studying, but what?
Reading.
Reading. And there's a technique to it. You don't read for 1 hour at a stretch, no. In fact, every average size book, like a 200-page book, shouldn't take you more than 10 hours to read.
So you can break that up into 10 days?
You can break that up. It can take 30 minutes a day when you're feeling good. You know, you wake up in the morning, you're having coffee. 30 minutes, you can finish maybe, you know, 10 pages or 20 pages. That's a lot. Mm-hmm. And again, as I also explained in the book, I think sometimes part of the problem is the literature that we read, the way some of these books are written. If you see well-written books, you see stories running through them. You see stories running. So every book that is, you know, and this is a message for authors, when you are writing a book, make sure you illustrate your point in a story format.
Even if it's a textbook?
Well, if it's an academic text, then that's different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but if it's a, you know, everyday reading, mm-hmm. you know, find a story. People love stories.
What about the fact that they say, so oftentimes, people read a lot of motivational books these days. Mm. And I find that as people who often are maybe at the bottom of the ladder, you talk about it in your book, where you read all of these books that helps you to be a better executive. Once you become an executive, that's the end. You know, what do you think about that?
I think, yes, you find that, and this is typical for many people who are still progressing in their career, you know, so as they are climbing the ladder, they recognize that they need to develop themselves. A part of that development could be reading and it could be, you know, taking courses and all that. Mm-hmm. But as soon as they become maybe CEO and all that, you know, they feel, well, you know, I've already achieved the ultimate. Mm-hmm. So I don't need to read anymore. But the thing about reading is that once you start doing it, once it becomes a habit, it's difficult, you know, to give up.
So what we're trying to do here is get people to develop that habit.
Absolutely.
Your book helps them to learn how to read more, but we'll discuss more on the panel on some tips that people can take away. But then I'm told that, somebody said I must ask you this question before I go, though. Are there any other books in the offing?
Oh, definitely. There are more books in the pipeline. But here's what we are doing. You know, in this era of social media, okay, you can have a book in print, as you have, but you can also have the electronic version of the book, e-book, which people can download onto their phones. You can also have the book in audio format.
And you have your book in SMS now, these days.
Absolutely. So every day, you can receive a small portion of the book, but condensed, you know, well illustrated, so that, you know, in a year, you can actually finish reading my book just on your phone by sending a code to an SMS, and then you get an SMS message.
So at the end of the day, the ultimate aim is, what kind of Nigeria do you see? What kind of world do you see?
At the end of the day, I think that we should emulate, you know, many of these countries that are doing extremely very well. If you look at countries that are successful, you know, whether it be in terms of entrepreneurship, whether it be in terms of good governance, Lee Kuan Yew said it, that the reason why Singapore became very, very successful was that it had the benefit of a cabinet of people who read voraciously.
Oh, wow.
And they shared the information
among
themselves.
So that's food for thought for
incoming
leaders. Be a voracious leader.
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, be a voracious reader to be a better leader. Well, that's nice, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I'll take a break, introduce my next guest, who incidentally is not even from Nigeria, but she's doing a lot of work in the area of trying to encourage children to read better by teaching them to spell better. We'll be meeting her in a short while first before we engage in our panel. Don't go away. Thank you, Martin. I appreciate
it.
Yes, up until a few weeks ago, my next guest was the Women's Month Ambassador for VLISCO in Ghana. Because of the work she does with kids, people have identified her as a woman who's living her dreams and helping others to live their dreams through the Spelling Bee competitions she runs in Ghana and has run in Ghana for more than 9 years now. But for the past 2 years, she's been coming to Nigeria to promote the same thing. Actually, in May, a new winner emerged from Nigeria in many more cities. It's my pleasure to introduce today my friend and sudden sister, because we're fellow VLISCO ambassadors in the past year until recently when we dropped the toga, to introduce Eugenia Tachie-Menson. Can you believe you're my guest on my show?
I can't. Well, we met almost, what, a year ago?
Yeah. Now, it was fun, right?
It was 1 year. So much fun.
What was the best thing about that ambassador thing? I don't know, because you're an ambassador, but somehow we're like, you know.
Yeah, I guess you're an ambassador, spokesperson for the VLISCO brand. For me, I think the best thing was the networking opportunities it brought.
I met you.
Thank you. So now I have a Nigerian sister. But more importantly, the platform gave me an opportunity to highlight what it is exactly that I do. Because I work with children, I was off the radar for a lot of adults. So I remember when I became VLISCO ambassador in Ghana, for example, a lot of parents, adults said, we don't know who you are. I said, ask your children. They'll tell you who
I am.
And
the children, incidentally, I hear in Ghana, it was the children that made their parents vote because it was a voting thing.
Yes, so
and everyone
parents.
Was voting for, and the parents asked, who is this Eugenia
woman? Yeah, they're like, who is this woman you're voting for? We don't know her. And I actually had a parent who walked up to me in church and said, you owe me a lot of money. My children have been taking my phone in the middle of the night and voting for you. And in the morning, I don't have any talk time on it. Mm-hmm. But yes, children really have carried me through. They made me what I am today. They have made my very existence, I must be honest with you, meaningful to me.
How did that happen? I mean, you schooled in the U.S.
In the U.K., actually. I was born in the U.S., did growing up in Ghana, went back to the U.K. to study. Mm-hmm. Through my bringing up, my parents were both diplomats, but disciplinarians as well. So guess what?
What number were you? I never asked
it was
you
number
that.
Number two out of three, and there were two boys, so I'm in the middle. But what we didn't think it was a cool thing. We never watched TV. Our source of entertainment was BBC Radio and books. So we owned our personal libraries. If you came into everybody's bedroom, they had their own library of, then it was Enid Blyton,
all the series,
the Hardy Boys, and what have you not. Mm-hmm. We had books, and I think then the reading culture was popular. So in school, for example, we would want to be exchanging books. I finished reading my Enid Blyton, can I have yours? So you take mine, I take yours, sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But for us, we grew up without watching TV until say, after O levels back then. Yes, there was no TV at home. My parents were very insistent.
Mm-hmm. And you thought they were punishing you?
Oh,
then?
God, we hated it because we never could join into conversations with friends.
The new shows.
Who were talking about the shows, like Cosby Show, and, you know, you have to play along and say, yeah, I saw it. You never did. You know, you never did see it, but you've got to play along to fit in. Mm-hmm. But would I do that to my children? Not necessarily. I would probably measure it so you could do maybe an hour, because I think in itself TV could be a learning tool. Mm-hmm. It's how it's used. Mm-hmm. But I think that maybe back in the day, this is how it needed to be done. My parents needed to do it. Mm-hmm. For us to turn out to become what we all love reading in the family. I mean, you could come home to, if we all met as a family, you could come home and we'll all be reading books. And you know how you find this generation staying on their phones and doing it? We stay and we put our heads in our books, and it's almost antisocial.
Reading, yeah. No, I'm surprised that you walked into the studio and there was a book in your bag.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize that you were still one of those who still read.
I do.
What are you reading now?
I'm reading The Secret Lives of Babashegi Wives.
Oh, this is Sefieta. Uh-huh, Sefieta, a Nigerian author.
No, it's not a Sefieta. Sorry, I can't say that. It's Lola. Lola Shaw something.
Okay.
Sorry, I can't say the name. But the reason I chose this book, which has been with me almost for a year, because I'm very busy, and I tend to read more of children's books than I read adult books, because I work in the industry and I want to be able to, when I'm telling children, when they're asking me, what books would you want to recommend? I want to be able to tell them what book to get without fear. Because you also want to be sure that the content is appropriate. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I tend to spend a lot more time reading children's books than mm-hmm. adult books. But this is a very lighthearted book. It's about a polygamous relationship that, mm-hmm. A polygamous man and the lives, really, of his wives.
Mm-hmm. Maybe Lola Shoshone.
Yes, yes, that's how you're saying.
She's supposed to be on this show, actually, yes.
And it keeps me through my travels. Mm-hmm. So anytime I'm coming to Nigeria, I grab it. Mm-hmm. On my short trips, I read it. But it's something that we've grown up with, the culture of reading. It keeps you out of trouble.
And it keeps you informed.
It keeps you very much informed. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've learned a lot of Nigerian culture through this book.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay, tell me something. How did the spelling bee competition start, and how does it work?
Yes, so how did it start generally, and then we'll come in on to Nigeria. Mm. So I was finishing my studies in the UK. I was majoring in PR, studying markets and communications. And I was so sure I wanted to become a PR person in Ghana. But by the time I was done studying, I realized that the PR, what we did called PR in Ghana, was nothing like what happened in the UK. So I wouldn't be doing the right thing if I came back home and insisted. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't fit. So I kind of thought, what am I going to do? And then I was just on the internet searching, and I stumbled upon it. I wasn't even searching for anything in particular. And I just stumbled upon a script spelling bee. And I thought, wow, it's interesting. I read about it and found out that it's a competition for children. And I thought, but it encourages reading and is meant to improve vocabulary and literacy skills. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. This is something I'd love to do. I love children. I love working with children. Mm-hmm. So maybe why don't I just see if I can apply for it for Ghana? So I put in an application, and I got the usual bureaucratic response. We will get back to you. Mm-hmm. So I moved on with my life. It was almost a year down the line where I had just been fired from my last job in
Ghana.
So
you did get a job eventually?
Yes, I did get a job when I came back to Ghana. I worked with a Nigerian friend, actually, who runs Charterhouse back in Ghana. Mm-hmm. I worked with them, and I moved on to a car company, because when I was in the UK, I was working for a car company. So I moved on to a car company in Ghana, and 6 months was a probation period into my work with them. He said, we're going to terminate our relationship with you. I was like, how do you do this? This was around Christmas time. I was like, I don't have a car, because I work with a car company. I had access to a car.
You hadn't bought one for yourself.
Yes, I hadn't bought one yet. So I was like, how am I going to move around? I had just come back trying to look cool, trying to fit in. And then, you know, you just slapped me with this. So, and they told me this on a Thursday, and I had to hand over a company vehicle by Monday. So I had only Friday. So tears in my eyes, drove back home, stopped by the post office, grabbed the letters, locked up myself in my room. I was living with my mom then. Locked up myself in my room, cried proper, and then decided to read the letters. And one of the letters was from Script Spelling Bee. We've gone ahead to give you the franchise to run the Spelling Bee in Ghana. For me, it was mixed blessings. Here, a door, or was it a window that had been shut in my face, and a massive door had been opened.
Tell me how it works. I'd shown you a picture earlier of, that was a Nigerian one, because I think that was a Nigerian one. Yes, this one.
Yes.
Is this the first one, or the current one, or the one that just finished?
So this is the first one we held last year in Osun State.
That was the first state where you had the spelling bee.
Yes, that's the first state we did the spelling bee, a la Script Spelling Bee. Mm-hmm. So again, as I was explaining earlier on when we were conversing, that our spelling competition is not really about standing there and throwing words at you for you to spell back at us. We train the children to understand the origins of the language. The origin of a language will decide how it should be pronounced and how it should be spelt.
For example?
So for example, the Greek alphabet does not have the letter F in it, but the F sound in the Greek alphabet is spelled with a PH. So you tell an 11-year-old that, and then you say, give me any word that has an F sound, but is spelled with a PH, telephone.
Yeah, phenomenal.
Phenomenal. So it's also child-led, the way we train our children. It's childless. So then they start going into what they already know and pulling out, you know, as it were, themselves. Oh, I think I've seen this. So this is what it means. So
they can't cram and come in.
No,
there.
They will not cram. And also they then understand why it is that telephone should not be spelled with an F.
Okay.
Because where it comes from, it's almost like spelling Shei with an SH.
Ah, you have become a Nigerian.
Yes, so.
You do have a Nigerian partner too, because yes, you couldn't have come in just like that.
Yes, I do. It's PDR Media, Akinleyi, Olu Phillips. I call him Akin.
Basically, Akin is easier for you.
Yes, Akin is much easier. I don't want to be massacring names. Mm-hmm. But so it's a PR and a media consultancy that have been very supportive and helpful of us.
Do you have any interesting stories or examples you can give to me about children who've done this and gone on to be better readers, for example? How does it help them?
Well, so in Nigeria is relatively young, so I can speak about Ghana. We've had parents, and normally we tend to want the feedback from parents we just ended a training session in Ghana, for example, and I had a parent who was actually my senior when I was in school saying, oh, it's just, you've trained my child for only 1 week and she's already telling me how words should be pronounced and she's already seeing how newscasters are making mistakes on TV. But yes, she's also started asking that they want to be reading Time magazine. We challenge them to read beyond the years because, one, we're in a very fast world. A 13-year-old Ghanaian child pitched against a 13-year-old American child. In terms of knowledge of current affairs, within the spelling bee, the American child will be ahead of the Ghanaian child.
Because they finish these competitions, like now the winner from Nigeria and the winner from Ghana will go on to do an international one.
So the winner from Ghana actually does participate in the international one.
Okay.
The winner from Nigeria goes as a guest. We are in the process of getting the final go-ahead Nigeria to compete.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay, really.
Because it's relatively new.
Because it's only 2 years old.
Yes, it's
so
only
this
2 years old.
The person who emerged in May is your second winner.
Will be our second winner.
Okay.
So we're hoping that in the very not too distant future, we should be able to get Nigeria to compete. We believe.
So how is it breaking into? Because, I mean, they already exist in some kind of spelling bee competitions in your country, in our country?
Yes, no, there are quite a number of spelling bees that exist. And
even in other parts of the world?
Yes, in other parts of the world. Even in the United States, there are other spelling competitions. Mm-hmm. And for me, generally, we're happy about that because then it means that there are other people who are also doing their bit to ensure that reading comes to stay with us. And so we really don't mind. We think that it's actually complementing, we're complementing each other's efforts, really. Mm-hmm. And as I say, the only difference with our ours is that we tend to focus more on understanding the technicalities that affect mm-hmm. a word. Mm-hmm. So it's, spelling is not about standing there and being asked, spell rain, and then, you know, you're stuck. Which rain are you asking me to spell? Are you asking me to spell the rain that comes from the heavens, or that, sorry, the sky? Mm-hmm. Or you're asking me to spell the rain of a king? Mm-hmm. Or you're asking me to spell the rain? And when you go through our competition, you're trained to never spell a word on the first attempt. So even if the word sounds like your name, Shay, mm-hmm. or Adesua.
So what do you say? You say, do you mean,
or can I have a, or does it mean a son of such and such? So if you said rain, for example, has it got to do with what comes from, water from the sky? Yes.
Then you know.
Then the child knows it's got to be R-A-I-N. Because it's important for us also, for our children to understand that there are homophones. That's where in communication you get people misunderstanding and miscommunicating.
And homophones technically are?
Homophones are technically words that sound similar but are spelt and mean different.
Like rain and rain.
Like rain and rain. Like rain and rain. And for us, this is also not just something we do for the children. We actually build the capacity of their teachers as well. Mm-hmm. We give them resources that to arm them to be able to teach this beyond just the competition. Mm-hmm. I mean, the competition is a fun aspect of it, but at the end of the day, they're still learning. But it's just that it's in a fun way.
So for you, reading is key. I mean, that's stupid. Is it a stupid question?
No, it's a stupid question. It's an obvious question. But reading is definitely key. I say that I traveled the world before through books, before mm-hmm. I actually physically traveled. Mm-hmm. I learned about cultures before I actually Absolutely. Lived in the countries. Mm-hmm. I knew how people thought before I actually met them. I can't wait to meet Chimamanda, but I know how she thinks already. And so I know how I'll speak to her when I meet her. But I think that reading, especially for as a habit for our young ones, is very important. I am also of the old school thought that you may be able to afford a tablet or any gadget where it's loaded with books. But what I say is that especially in Ghana, where we're having power challenges, where, you know, two, 3 days, you may not have power. You know, you may have a generator. What if it breaks down and your child cannot connect their charger to the...
So go for the good old hard copies.
Go for the good old hard copies. There is just something about
the smell
seeing... Because if a child is sitting on an iPad, for example, how can you tell they're reading?
Good point. But I'll take a break because we must engage at the... I'll take a break and then I'll see my next guest.
Yeah.
And then ultimately we will engage on the
Great.
Panel. Thank you, Eugenia. I appreciate
Thanks for
your presence.
Having me.
We'll be back in a short while. Yes, welcome back. My next guest on the show is both a writer and runs a publishing house here in Lagos. And some people would describe the thing that he does as madness, considering that reading is still a big problem, at least as far as I know, in Nigeria. But he's the author of one of the funniest or most deep books I have read in recent times. It's called Fine Boy. And it's my pleasure to introduce Fine Boy Eghosa Imasuen. A fine boy.
We try.
You try.
Good genes.
A fine boy and a father. How many kids do you have now?
Twins.
Twins. I mean, I read the account. Those are your twins. And do they read?
Yeah, they do. They do. They're seven now.
They're seven now, yeah. And they read. Yeah. So, but you're originally a medical doctor.
Yes, I am.
What role did reading play in your life that made you end up being a writer and now a publisher?
You know, I actually do not have the classic narrative of having written all my life.
Or read all your life.
Read all my life, definitely, mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think there was something that happened when my father heard that my novel was about to be, when I told him I had a publishing contract for my first novel, he just said, I always knew you would write. I was 30 at the time, so he always knew I would write. Why did you punish me and force me to read medicine?
Did he force you to read medicine?
No, he actually did. Nobody did. I actually really loved medicine. I really did. Writing came as a happy accident when I was in my late 20s, and I read, and I just started writing. I can't, there was no push, it just happened. And I sent my manuscript out to the new publishing houses that were coming. You know, there was Farafina, there was Cassava Republic, there's other names. Mm-hmm. And I was, lo and behold, I got a reply from Mukhtar. Yeah, so that's how I got the contract for my first book. Mm-hmm. Then from there, life just kind of happened. I started running the family business as a first son.
Then, from a dual land.
Yes, then as first sons and fathers I want to do, we had an argument, so... Then from there, Mukhtar said, you're running a business already and you write, come and help me run GETTV Limited, which is the parent company that owns the Farafina brand. Mm-hmm. And 2012, 2013, I started running. So it's been 2 years now.
No, was it a difficult decision?
No, not really. It was more difficult for family to accept that the doctor in the family was about to let
give up medicine.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I practiced medicine for 12 years. I think I tried.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So now this is fulfilling both financially and otherwise. Because I wonder, people say Nigerians don't read. Does that bother you? Is that true?
Yes, it does. But I think it's a more nuanced statement. It's like, what do Nigerians read? You know, by the time you have economic realities, escapism becomes a difficult concept. So you don't want to really spend that much energy relaxing. So watch a film instead. If you want to read something important, textbook or motivational book,
mm-hmm.
you know, 21 ways to make a living.
Yeah.
Yeah. But those guys never tell you the 22nd way, which is write a book about 21 ways to make a living for suckers to buy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it's that funny thing where it's what do people want to read?
Mm-hmm.
And are you telling stories important for them? Now, what is fulfilling about what we do is that it's two ways. We're both searching for an audience of readers, and we are actively trying to keep something alive that we do not want to die.
So
in terms of business decisions, it can be bad, but we are actively saying that, no, you can make money from this thing. So we strive and struggle, find ways of structuring the business so that we can have a revenue stream that pays for the good, for the stories that we want to tell.
So what's our revenue stream for Farafina?
We have our publishing services, because we spent 3, 4, 5 years reinventing the wheel. And so we have our publishing services imprint where we now give out those services for a fee. So you have a book that you really want to write that we don't think is, that we don't have as much, maybe it's not in our primary focus. So you have our prestige publishing services imprint where you can come, you pay for the, and we offer you publishing services.
What does it mean when you say you're publishing a book?
It means...
Because you're not necessarily writing it.
No. Mm-hmm. It means getting a manuscript in different stages of completion. It could be mm-hmm. already done, or you could follow the writer through the process of writing the manuscript. And having editors work on it. Parallel to that, cover design concepts are coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Then also project managing the print run, because we are not printers.
Oh, yeah.
Because that is kind of really distracting. So you can't really run a printing press and a publishing house. It's two mind states.
Mm-hmm.
So we project manage printing with our printing partners, mm-hmm. both in Nigeria and in Southeast Asia.
Mm-hmm. One of the first big things that you guys did was the Purple Hibiscus. I mean,
yes,
that kind of blew Chimamanda's first book.
Yes, it was.
You know, how did you guys get the rights for that book? I know she's a friend of the house.
Yeah, she's a friend of, she was a friend of, you know, before the print, before the Farafina became a publishing house itself, it started mm-hmm. as an online magazine.
Yeah,
and this was 2003, 2004, mm-hmm, and she mm-hmm. and a few other people then, yeah, were contributors. Mm-hmm. So when
short
our first
stories.
Novel came out, I think Mukhtar had already seen it and said, okay, as soon as this is ready, can I have the Nigerian rights for
Mukhtar,
this?
Mukhtar, that's Mukhtar.
Mukhtar Bakare, the founder of the company.
The founder of Farafina Company.
Yes.
So now, what do you think about the fact that people can read on tablets, people can read on their phones, people can read, does that make the hard copy print go extinct?
No, I think it's not an either or, it's an and thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it's both, all tools are important. For one, I run a publishing house and I'm increasingly finding it difficult to hold on to a print book. So I take my Kindle wherever I go, my e-reader. But there's also the problem with reading becoming little bites of information. So there's a problem with attention span. How do you keep somebody glued for a novel? So you find publishers demanding more of readers. But there must be a meeting place where you can say, no, writers, write more to your audience now, and you will find those readers. Mm-hmm. You know, so
you think that we can grow the reading culture?
Yes, it's
and
inevitable.
What can help us?
It will happen again. It's a cycle. Things will get better. People will read leisurely. Things will deep. People will read motivational. Things will get better. They'll read leisurely again. It's a cycle. But the thing about it is that, like I always insist, we, as a people, I think we read. If you go to the secondhand bookshops at Ojoelegba, NRA Junction, Ring Road, Akpapava, you see people, I call them the bend down bookshops. Their books don't last.
Mm-hmm.
But those books are 100 naira, 200 naira a copy. How do you compete with a complete book? Or those books are what they call remediaring.
Mm-hmm.
So a book has gone through hardback, paperback to trade paperback, and the remainders are over there are now shipped because books are on zero duty.
So they're really cheap. What you're saying is that if things are interesting, if it fits a particular audience,
and if it's cheap.
And if it's cheap,
yeah,
that's what about Farafina. The books, you make an effort to make sure that they're affordable,
yes,
those novels.
Yes, we do.
You know, and that's one strategy. But what do you think reading, how can we interest people in reading more?
Basically, you have role models who obviously read. You have a kind of culture where that raises those. So you have even there was something that a friend of mine was doing, a series of reading events where it would bring stars who typically you wouldn't think read, you know, gentlemen like the musicians and the rest, the hip hop guys, and they would talk about books that they had read. And in that small drop in an ocean way, you're changing minds. Then it also comes from home. Parents have to buy books for their children. You're thinking of a toy or a book, buy a book. And once in a while, the child will crawl to it and open it. And that seed, you don't know where that seed will take that child.
So personally in your life, what role would you say reading has played?
Made me a doctor. Made me think I was very brilliant. But it made me a doctor and everything, because brawn I don't have. I was not an athlete. I was in
but
the
clapping
squad.
But you look like you have brawn.
It's genetic. Now are you? You know, so I was in the, but without books, I was a typical geek. So books were my life and made me read medicine, practice for 12 years, I run a publishing house now. So I basically leave books because I read a lot as a child.
When is your next book coming?
Hi.
You're too busy being the CEO.
Of a company, like, too busy running other people's books. But I'm working on something and I hope you guys like it, maybe in a year or two.
Okay, thank you very much. And I appreciate the fact, especially because your plane had 3 attempts at landing.
I'm telling you.
To make it to this show. So, and when they told there was a windshed, what was the plane like at that time? People were praying.
People were praying and clapping, and people were praying and shouting and screaming. Then there was this embarrassed laughter when the plane landed, because they were like,
At last, we are down.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm sure I might read that in your book, maybe someday.
Yes, you
just think about writers. They pick all kinds of things from everywhere. So thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. We'll
take a break, and the rest of the program will continue, if you don't go away. Yes, welcome back. Very quickly, I'll read you some rude statistics that made Nigerians wake up somewhere last year. This was in 2010, actually. Mr. Ike Onyechere, he's of the Exams Ethics International. He's the chairman. And they released something that showed that in 2000 and 2001 exams, NECO exams, they announced a pass rate of 100%. All candidates passed all papers they entered for in the 2 years. In 2007, they announced that of the 987,000 candidates, 97% people of the children passed. By 2009, it came down to 1.585% of Nigerian children passed their exams. And he went on to say, is it possible for Nigeria to move from being a country of geniuses to being a country of complete idiots in a space of 10 years? From 100% to 1.85%. And even the teachers that have been tested, we find that the literacy rate, whether it's going up or down, I don't know. And it's all in this book. You quoted it. I'm back on this section to talk to the two people who are actual readers and doing actual things to try to get people to read more. As usual, I'm going to start with you, because on this show, there's a guy and a girl. I start with the guy. I turn the ladies first around. Is that okay?
More than
Martin, I want you to speak to that question of, are we raising idiots because they don't read at all or because they're not being taught well?
That's a chicken or egg
situation.
I keep going back to Singapore. One of the things Lee Kuan Yew did in Singapore. Singapore is just a country of about 5 million people, right? Mm-hmm. And I just read that their universities, 2 of them, are among the top 75 in the whole world. The same number as Germany, Japan, and China. And what he did was to invest not necessarily in infrastructure, but in teachers and what? Students. Okay, because he believed that you can't give what you don't have. In 2008, also from my book, Kwara State tested some teachers, about 19,000 teachers, secondary school teachers. They gave them primary 4 tests. Of that 19,000, about 2,000 were graduates. Okay?
These students, the teachers?
Of the teachers. Mm-hmm. You know, less than 10 graduates passed a primary 4 aptitude test in public schools.
So is
that was in Kwara. So you can imagine, so across the nation, it's an epidemic. So when you have teachers that are poorly educated, what do you expect? They can't train smart people.
No, these are not classroom education. Is that similar to what's happening in your country, Ghana, for example?
Very much so. Very much so. So we're having a lot of passes, actually, as you stated. And for us, the question is, can we now go beyond passes and actually start having excellent grades? Mm-hmm. A lot of our children are failing in their examinations because they don't even understand the language in which the question has been set.
So it's back to the basic of reading, isn't it?
And the lack of it.
It's actually the lack of it.
Mm-hmm. Because we're not reading. And because and I'm getting technical and academic here, mm-hmm. because we're not teaching the language the way it's meant to be taught.
So they fear reading.
Well, so the fact that they don't understand, for example, in Ghana, there's a test we do, which we call dictation. So you're dictated to, you're given a word basically, and you have to spell it right back.
Mm-hmm.
I have had challenges with that because I keep saying what that strategy does is it takes away all homophones, words that sound similar, mm-hmm. but have different meanings. So what you're doing is you're limiting the child's vocabulary there and then. You're dumbing them. That's what you're doing. Mm-hmm. You will avoid a word like rain because it has three or four
different options.
Similar, yes. So why would you do that? It's how we're teaching the language.
Okay, you think differently.
Yes, excuse me. I think part of the problem too is there's too much focus on curriculum. You know, recently my daughter was given an assignment, and the assignment was for her to write about 2,000 words. First of all, mention three books that you have read that are not part of your academic curriculum,
mm-hmm.
okay? And then give us a summary on one of them. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember I gave her Americana, of course she cited it,
mm-hmm.
Chimamanda.
Mm-hmm.
I gave her a book called The Traveler's Guide,
mm-hmm.
fantastic book, and then the third book, and she remembered, and she had read it. And then each time
how
she
old
reads
is
the
she?
Book, well, my daughter is she's in high school.
It doesn't matter.
Yes.
To your daughter.
But I remember that from when she was growing, when she was much younger, you know, we would take Reader's Digest.
And read.
So I think it's a culture of reading that is a problem. You know, parents need to, you know, if you are a parent and you do not read, it's not likely.
But your child will read. Okay, let's do it. Let's do this. We have 3 minutes to say to people, what are the things to do? Because sometimes I feel that it might be the fear of reading or not knowing how to read that's the issue here. So there must be some basic technique. So give me 3 basic techniques that work for both of you that people can learn from.
Okay. For me, I think the first thing, very fundamental thing is choose a book that aligns with your interest. Everybody has an interest.
Even if you like to swim.
If you like to swim, you like premiership, there's mm-hmm. a book called Soccernomics, fantastic book. If you like boxing, if you like, you know, television.
So how do you make the time to read that book? Okay.
Yeah, so if
choose
you
if a good,
choose a book that aligns
mm-hmm.
with your interest.
Two?
That's one. Two is read in chunks of time. Don't read at a stretch.
It's not an exam.
No, it's not an exam, exactly. You know, that way it's fun. I can read for 5 minutes. I can read for, you know, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Don't read for 1 hour.
Three.
And then the third one is begin to just fall in love with books. Just love books and all that.
Eugenia?
So I would say my tips will be for children. And my first was going to be make sure you can identify what your child is interested in. So if they're a science geek, you're buying them books within, or they like solving problems or mysteries. You find them books like that.
Find them what they're interested in.
Find
nice
them
for them.
That's the first one. The second one I'll say is read at leisure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Read at leisure, not like it's not like an exam. Mm-hmm. So the drive to school, they should be reading and not talking or listening to radio necessarily.
That's good.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And especially
thirdly,
in Lagos where there's traffic.
Yes, they're sitting in Accra, sitting in the car and the kids are looking up in the sky. You know, they're bored. Thirdly, make sure that you make it fun. So if you task them to read and they're reading in a car on Friday, so what were you reading about? Mm-hmm. Okay, and then turn it, make it competitive. They are siblings.
Discuss it.
You know, discuss it and then make it competitive. So who read, who finished reading their book and what it meant, and okay, so you get something for it. Kids work with a reward system. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the way to instill it in them. But I want to add a fourth one, which he mentioned earlier on. If as a parent you're not reading, none of these will work.
So I think that's the key. It means we also, yeah, as parents, either biological or otherwise, raising people, we have to teach them a good example. Ask me what the last book I read was.
I won't.
Don't disgrace me. But the truth is, what I do know, like you said, is I'm going to determine, going from today, what I do, actually, is I have a book in my car,
yeah,
and there's traffic in Lagos.
Yeah.
So even if it's one page a day, it's, yeah, a spiritual book, yeah, so it's okay.
Yeah.
I read it, you know, yes, one page a day, and I'm not in a hurry.
Yeah.
But the truth is, we are complete, we are made by what we read. Like Eugenia said earlier, what we see in the world, we first see it here.
Absolutely.
So I wonder what's going to happen if we are not learning to learn more, like Lee Kuan Yew has said, according to you. So I want to say thank you for coming, and thank you to all my guests on the show. We'll see you again next week, and I hope you'll pick up the reading habit. See you again.